up, everyone? Mustang 2005 here. I'm at historic Richmondtown today. We're going to see the Civil War reenactment.
Well, welcome to Richmondtown and the Civil War reenactment.
We're here at the courthouse. We're going to do a tour of all the buildings and wait for the reenactment to start. First time I've seen the upstairs of the courtroom. I feel like this area will be haunted.
Stuff we use today, but you know, you realize back then you really absolutely delicious.
Well, they had that.
And if it's authentic, there's no fillers or anything in it.
Yeah. Yeah. Just using the basic ingredients that are available at the time. Mm-hmm. Just pretty much everything today. As far as dry herbs.
And then you had different types of.
I was going to say that because most of the dresses are tattered and
Grinder, it's used for grinding your coffee beans. And that coffee grinder, after you put it in on top, it comes down through a pot or through a pail, and you turn around, and you would turn around and take your coffee and pour it in your bag for your store, and then you lay it up here on a scale and say how much it weighs.
Oh, that's it. Stay next to it because you got the right apparatus.
How you doing?
Hi.
Oops, sorry, sir.
Okay. No, he's up from,
okay, let's go around the back. Let's just stand it up.
1930 to about 1930.
Wow. James, did you hear that?
Yeah.
And this is, these lights here are your Brooklyn lights. What they call Brooklyn lights. Thank you. And that's typical right here. That's very, very typical.
And you're a half man. Oh, really? He's a half man.
Okay, I didn't see over here for a second.
Oh, boy.
Oh, wow. It's a good head.
Coffee.
Buttons and things like that, and motions.
How you doing?
He's a woodmaker. What am I doing?
What you see here is a carpenter shop as it would have been about 1850 or so.
Nice.
With the limitations of the time.
Wait, do you sell wood too?
Do I sell wood? No.
He makes it, buddy.
I make sell things that I make out of wood.
My dad likes doing wood stuff too.
Well, it's something that appeals to human wood. People like wood.
Yeah.
There's no doubt about it.
Well, he's an old soul, and it's one of his hobbies.
Well, you don't have to be old to like wood.
Oh, yeah, sure.
I liked wood when I was young.
Oh, yeah? It's good stuff, though.
Well, it's wood is a
Gabriel,
is readily turned into things by hand.
Mm-hmm.
That's one of its attractions.
I love the smell of wood, too.
Well, in this shop, I'm limited by the year 1860,
mm-hmm.
which means I cannot have inventions that come after that time.
Oh.
So we're making things the same way they were made, not only in that year, but in the mm-hmm. countryside. This Staten Island then was farm country. And we're using the same tools and the same materials. What I'm making right now are the drawers for this spice cabinet.
Cool.
And
these are cool. Yeah, the spoon holders.
I like that better.
You signed up. You have to come. There's a book on the phone.
So this is just a really light, thin cotton for the summertime. So it's something lighter.
Right,
like
right.
A really heavy, dark fabric.
Exactly, okay.
I'm just mending the petticoat.
Okay. Uh-huh.
Oh,
nice.
Nice.
Oh, this is the other side of the store.
Ballots and machines and my hands.
What do you solder? What metal?
Well, not lead.
That's what I was wondering.
Yeah, it's partially tin and I don't know what the other part was. It'll come to me later. But it's we don't use lead anymore. But what they used to do,
you can get fumes off that too. Not healthy for you.
Yeah, the lead. Working with lead is not great, but they used to make like tin baby bottles soldered at the mouth with lead.
Mm-hmm.
That's just, they didn't know any better.
Yeah.
They didn't know any better.
And fruits too.
Mm-hmm. All full of lead.
Yep.
And then I use a flux and my copper soldering irons. And
do you have a crimping tool for putting to,
like aps-c? And this is called a hatchet stake. They all have different purposes.
Oh.
So what I do on my hatchet stake is hook my end onto the stake and use a mallet to bang it over so I have just a little edge turned over. And then on the opposite side, I have a little edge turned over the other way. And then I bend them together and I make sure that they want to be together, that they fit snugly. So they're all there. So what I do next to make sure that the seam stays together is I put it through this machine, which I'm not gonna do because this is a demonstration piece. So the cup would go onto this machine on the seam, and then I turn this so the wheel rolls over it. And the seam, because of this part of it is flat, and then the wheel has a little turned edge.
Uh-huh.
So you get like a little lump that holds the seam in place
really
tight. And then, to make sure that it's really tight and waterproof and all of that good stuff, then I will solder the seam to make sure that it is watertight and all of that good stuff. Yeah.
Solder.
Of tin and another metal that is slipping my mind, but it's just metal that I'm using with my soldering iron. I heat this up to like...
Welded together.
Welding.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So I heat this up to like 450 degrees, and then this melts right onto it. And I kind of use it like a glue.
Well, some of us gotta fight the war at home. Got a bum leg in Antietam. You want to fight? You want to fight the Union Army?
No, thank you.
Thank you.
163. The regiment, I'm going to put you in the 178.
I wasn't looking.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Miss Sarah did for us. Okay. Okay. All right. I'm gonna go wash this up.
Even today, the highest rank is the 2-star general. It's only by appointment you get 3 and 4 right. stars, right?
And well, he got 4 stars afterwards.
Yeah, he was 3 and then he went to 4.
Right.
And the other two guys got one right up there too, right? Sheridan, there's another guy.
Yeah, I think they both eventually.
We are portraying soldiers.
Right across the street. Okay, just see it though. But it's just odd.
A lot of these guys had New York connections. A lot of them.
Were the bayonets always mounted? Or?
No. Very rarely would you have the bayonet on in combat because the engagement distance was 400 yards and then close in. You'd usually engage at 600 to 400 yards and then you get closer. By the time you got to bayonet range, there wouldn't be anybody left.
Why have added weight to run?
It's going to affect your aiming. It's heavier. Okay, sure. I'll let Mark know.
Yep. What if the bayonet weigh?
Maybe 2 pounds.
Yeah, 2 pounds to attack. Yeah, it's
unnecessary
extra weight, right?
Exactly. Just like modern rifles, you're not going to carry the bayonet on it if you don't need to. There are 101 uses for it, too. Like, they're used for everything. Like, we're using it to cook.
Right.
Candle holders.
Sure. It's a jack-of-all-trades weapon. The jack-of-all-trades.
Yeah, it's great.
All right.
Yeah.
Sorry, kind of get out of the shot.
No, you're fine.
And stand out and roll farms and stuff. I wasn't allowed to see that.
Thank you.
I have a feeling that Ellis Austin took these pictures. She was a famous photographer on the island. Painted oyster. That looks like it might be Newdorp. No, it's not. It's Tompkinsville. Interesting. Wow, I didn't know we had that. This is also Diamond Hills. Interesting. Right, I even had hot air balloons. Can't do that now with all the airports. Where the boat is.
We're right over here. Crazy. They also had a stadium named after them, where the race cars went. That was in Port Richmond. I wasn't born yet, though. That's interesting. Sea view. Back when it was built. If you can only see it now. Kind of reminds me of Mr. Rogers.
She had a diary when she was 11. I am very sick and did not go to school. I played paper dolls in my playroom. I had two houses fitted up. One
Ouija board. I remember those. Can't imagine how old that is.
They said they didn't make babies. 100 years ago, they started making baby dolls. Before that, they used to make dolls that looked like people in your family.
Do you like that?
No, she just made a cat.
Baby dolls and stuffed toys. Look who's got a monkey over here.
I remember that. I had one of those. Although that's probably like from the 50s. Just by the ink on the board.
This is the old woman who lived in the shoe. See it? It wasn't an old woman who lived in the shoe. She
Hey, Ninja Turtles. I think that's a G.I. Joe. Yep, I had one. And that's it for the museum.
Two ranks, right face. Forward, line file, left, park.
Ladies and gentlemen.
In place, rest.
Thank you all for coming. I want to present the Liberty Rifles. These are a Civil War reenactment group. They come from varied parts of the United States. First of all, I'd like you to give them a hand for even showing up here today.
Yeah, thank you.
They are going to be demonstrating a firing drill right now. On your itinerary, you'll see there's two of these.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good afternoon. Thank you. I hear the bells this afternoon. Thank you for being here today. What you see here is a small squad of men as they would have appeared right here on Staten Island in July and August of 1863. We are portraying men of the 178th New York Volunteer Infantry. The 178th New York was formed in 1863 out of some independent small companies of men from Western New York and the Buffalo region, and the remainder of them were formed from right here in New York City to make this new regiment, the 178th. And the 178th would be quartered at Camp Sprague, which was nowadays, you know it as Miller Field out in Newdorf. Miller Field, as we know today, had been a military establishment for a long time, since before the Civil War. It was really a perfect place to do it. It was flat, it was on the water, so it was comfortable. It was accessible by the train. It took about 20 minutes by train from the ferry down to the Newdorf station, which existed then, about the same today on a good day. So really, it was a good place to muster a lot of men in one place to teach them how to be soldiers. Now, we're going to be talking about the marching drill in a little bit. Before a soldier was even handed a rifle, he was taught how to march, how to stand, and how to move as one. So the weapon drill would come second, but So this is what we're going to talk about now. When we think about the Civil War, we think about men standing in lines like this, you know, hundreds of men all together, shoulder to shoulder, all firing at once, and we think, okay, well, somebody might hit something. Well, that's an old way of thinking. With these weapons, almost everyone is going to hit something. Now, in the older days with the smoothbore muskets, when you think of the Revolutionary War, their point is to just fire as much downrange so something gets hit, not as much about the individual aiming his piece. But starting in with the invention of the rifle, which is a technological advance over the smoothbore musket, soldiers are now going to learn target practice. They're going to be trained as individuals to aim their piece and to fire and to actually hit what they're aiming at different lengths. To the point where they would even spend time just learning how to aim before they even fired the weapon. They would be taught to use their sights on the rear of their weapon, lining it up with the front sight, and just holding their weapon steady and looking at a target down range, and just getting used to the feel of that, getting used to the way a target would look at a certain distance. And they would say, okay, that target is 225 yards away. Just practice aiming at that for a while. Really, really starting slow before they even fired a shot. Sometimes they would do something called, they would take their rifles indoors, and at a lit candle, they would take their weapon and just fire off a percussion cap that we're going to be talking about to see if they could extinguish the candle, just to see if their aim was steady. And then once they were good at that, they would then learn the process of actually loading and firing the weapon. Now, as I mentioned before, these are rifle muskets. Musket referring to the length of the weapon, and a rifle musket meaning that the inside of these barrels is lined with grooves. What that's going to do in concert with the projectile that's being fired, these are 1 ounce soft lead bullets that are cone shaped. When the gunpowder explosion happens in the breech, that lead will expand and fit into those grooves and come out spinning like when you put a spin on a football. It's going to give it a really straight trajectory, and it's going to go downrange at what you aim at. Now, there's a whole bunch of physics involved as far as what the bullet does when it leaves the barrel. Though it's going downrange, there is a little bit of an arc to it. So learning how to aim and fire was not just as simple as pointing at it. There was a lot of compensation that had to be done, so the arc of the bullet would travel and eventually hit it maybe on the way down, depending on how far away it was. But that's advanced stuff. We're not going to get into that. We're just going to talk about the mechanics of loading and firing the weapon. The men were trained in what was called load in 9 times, and each step was important because the following step was reliant on the previous one. If you eliminated one of those steps, the weapon would not work. So when they were trained by the numbers, each step one at a time, so it was drilled into their minds, so it became second nature to them, because there's no room for error on the battlefield. So men would be instructed in small groups like this, and we're going to go through the load in 9 times procedure without actually loading the weapon, just to show you what the motions looked like, and then we're going to actually load the weapons and fire them in a couple different ways. Attention, squad! Load in 9 times. Load. Load is the number one step. The weapon is brought to the front. The men are already preparing for the next command. Their cartridge boxes, if they're on a belt like mine, might be slid around to the front. If they're on straps like most of them have, they will just open their boxes and prepare to take out a cartridge. The next command is handle cartridge. The cartridges in question are small paper tubes like this with their tied at the bottom and with a tail at the top. Inside this paper cartridge is a gunpowder charge at the top part. Below that is the bullet all wrapped up together. And then with this paper tail folded on and carried in the cartridge box. The cartridge box can carry 40 rounds of ammunition. Cartridges are carried loose in the top part of these metal tins. And then in the lower tray is what's called an arsenal pack. This is how the ammunition is issued, in packs of 10 with a roll of percussion caps wrapped in there that we're going to be talking about in a moment. In combat situations, you hear accounts of soldiers being issued extra arsenal packs to carry as many 60, sometimes even 80 rounds on their person when they go into action. So now you see they have their cartridge by their teeth. That's preparing for the next command, which is tear cartridge. At that point, they would bite off that paper tail of the cartridge, and that would expose the gunpowder that's in there, and they're now, their hand is by the muzzle of the weapon, ready for the next step, which is charge cartridge. They've now inverted their hand. The powder would be dumped from this paper tube down the barrel, and if we were firing with actual bullets, the paper wrapping around the bullet would be taken, peeled away, and the bullet would be seated just in the muzzle of the weapon. So they say, charge cartridge. Then now their hand has gone to that ramrod, ready for the next command, which is draw rammer. Now we've taken out these ramrods. This is very important. You need the gunpowder at the bottom of the barrel, but you need that bullet sitting directly on top of that gunpowder for this weapon to have the right effect, because that bullet needs to travel that length of the barrel to get the spin on it and to go out the way you want it to. The next command is ram cartridge, at which point the men will have pushed that bullet all the way down, seated it on top of the powder, tamped it down to make sure that it's snug and that there are no gaps in there. Now you see how easily that ramrod went down. These are clean weapons that have not been fired yet today. You can imagine what soft lead and corrosive gunky black powder is going to do to the inside of one of these barrels. The spacing between the bullet and the barrel is going to get smaller and smaller the more these weapons are fired. So this process of ramming the cartridge is going to become a little bit of a struggle over time. The next command is return rammer. Making sure that the rammer is returned to the channel underneath the weapon. You'll notice a safety feature that is built into the manual of arms. Look at where these men's hands are. Their hands are not over the barrel. This would now be a live weapon, and they're only using their pinky to secure that ramrod out of the way. This is just, you know, extra safety procedure, even in wartime, that had to be followed and was drilled into the men, so that was second nature to avoid accidents happening. The next command is prime. The weapons are now brought up to this position, and now we're looking at the rear of the weapon. These weapons are called percussion locks, meaning that the actual ignition that sets off the powder is done by a percussion cap. A percussion cap is this little tiny brass thing that looks like a little top hat filled with a compound called fulminate of mercury. This fulminate of mercury cap is set upon what we call the cone or the nipple of the rifle right here underneath the hammer, such that when the weapon is fired, the hammer will strike that percussion cap. That will cause a small spark that travels into the barrel, sets off the gunpowder charge, and fires the weapon. So you can see that everything that's been done to this point is absolutely necessary. You really can't eliminate any of these steps for speed or for efficiency. Everything needs to be done. And now, when they're in this position, their weapons are theoretically loaded, and the commander would order shoulder arms. So now everyone would be in a position where their weapons could be then fired. So then the commander has several options how to deliver that fire downrange. If this were a company of 100 men, as part of a battalion of maybe 1,000 men, ideally at the beginning of the war, they could command to fire by company, at which point each company of 100 men, alternating, leapfrogging from down the line, every other company might fire all at once. So you'll have 100 men firing, then another 100 men firing, then another 100 men firing, and then the companies that were skipped will have their 100 men fire and their 100 men fire. That's a lot of lead going downrange. If they want to deliver a really percussive blow all at once, they could fire by battalion, meaning the entire regiment fires their weapon at once. They could fire by wing. The left wing of the regiment could fire all at once. And then the right wing of the regiment could fire all at once. They could fire by rank. We could have the rear rank fire and then reload. And then the front rank can fire and reload. And they would alternate, so on and so forth. There's the fire by file. Each of these two men is considered a file, and a company could order them to fire two men at a time, working down the line. So there are all sorts of different ways, but you have to remember, these are single shot weapons. And no matter what, every time you fire it, you then have to reload it and do the process all over again. So rapid fire is not really that much of a factor, and a commander would have to choose which of those tactics would be best suited for the threat at hand, depending on the distance to the enemy or what tactical advantage had to be done. So, of course, on the actual battlefield, they're not going to be calling out those individual commands. They're not going to be telling them handle cartridge, ram cartridge, charge cartridge, and all that stuff. Theoretically, they should have been trained and they should know what they're doing. So in real time is what we're going to do. Now we're going to about face the men. We're going to wheel around so you stay in this position. We're going to see what loading and firing will look like in real time. Attention squad. Left wheel, march. Squad, halt. Load. So see if you can pick out the individual steps that we taught before. They've handled the cartridge. They're tearing the cartridge. Dumping the powder down the barrel. Now you can see that every man is doing it at a slightly different speed. So that's why it's important for them to come back to that shoulder arms position so the commander, whoever's in charge of them, knows that everybody is loaded and ready to fire. Now all told, 3 shots a minute is ideal. Sometimes 4 shots a minute can happen. But again, that rate of fire is going to be diminished the longer they are under fire, that they're in action. But now I see they're all at shoulder arms and they're ready to fire. Now I'm a sergeant, and the sergeant position in a company is the first sergeant who really runs the company, you know, that's my opinion, but would be in front on the march. But when the men are loading and firing, the sergeants are in the rear ranks. They're with the officers. And they're keeping an eye on everybody, making sure that they're all doing what they're supposed to do, that they're staying and firing and everybody's doing the right thing. That's another safety feature that's written into the manual of arms, to have these men in the rear ranks that are called file closers, watching the loading and firing process and make sure that everyone is doing what they're supposed to be doing. Fire by squad, ready. First command, ready, gets them to the ready position. They have now pulled their hammer back. There are 2 steps on these hammers. The first position, the half cock position, is a safety feature. The weapon can't be fired, but it brings it back just enough to get that cap on the cone. They're now in the ready position, which is a second click. These weapons are ready to fire. Aim. Fire. Shoulder, arms.
Oh my god! Oh my god! Oh my god! Oh my god!
Now, that's everybody firing downrange of the target. The aim of an individual is not really that much of a factor here because you've got so many men firing downrange, somebody's going to get hit, certainly. But these men are being trained, as I said before, to aim and fire and to dictate where they're firing on their own. So if there's a target that might be in loose order, you might have what's called a skirmish line, where men are loose in loose formation, maybe with 10, 15 paces between them coming across the field. It's up to the individual to pick his target and to aim and fire at a given target. So you hear in movies a lot of the time men commanding fire at will, and then the joke, which one's will? We don't get into that. But that command is not necessarily written into the manual of arms, but there is a way to get to that. I talked about firing by file before, where each group of 2s will fire in turn down the line. After that has happened, they're on their own to load and fire until told otherwise. Squad, load. Firing by file. Squad, ready. Commence, fire. Now they've fired in turn down the line. You can imagine a squad is firing on its own. They're not waiting for orders. They see a shot, they're taking it. Cease firing. Now when the command is given to cease fire, they don't just stop what they're doing and wait around. They load their weapons one more time because the ceasefire order may then be countermanded and they may have to fire again. Now you might notice that one of the weapons wasn't as loud as the others very suddenly. That's a misfire. The percussion cap went off, but the powder did not. That absolutely happens, especially once the weapon gets dirtier over time. There's a lot of fouling inside the breech, but also this is a very tiny hole that spark has to travel through to get to that gunpowder. That gets clogged very easily. So every man is issued a little wire pick like this that's carried in their cap box, and if their weapon is misfiring, they're gonna come off the line
and just clean it out as best they can and then give it another shot. Now you can imagine how noisy it is on a battlefield, right? A lot of guns going off, a lot of men yelling, a lot of smoke, it's very confusing. If there's a lot of men firing and your weapon doesn't fire, you might not notice it. So your weapon might theoretically still be loaded, and in the excitement of everything that's happened, you didn't notice that your weapon didn't recoil either, and that there was no flame coming out of the front muzzle. So there are instances where weapons are double loaded, triple loaded, in some really far out cases, 5 or 6 rounds might be loaded in the barrel. That's why it's important to remember your training, because these men might have been civilians last week, and you're taking them from their desk jobs, from their farm jobs, and you're making them soldiers. Training is important. Soldiers have to be made. Nobody naturally knows how to do this. So everything that these men learn, they're going to spend hours and hours and hours every day learning it, because there is no room for error. The squad is loaded. We're going to fire one more fire by squad, and then we'll take your questions. Squad! Fire my squad, ready! Aim! Fire! Shoulder, arms! Left wheel, march! Squad, halt! Order, arms! In place, rest! So if you have any questions on what we've
questions.
Oh, hello. I hope you enjoyed this video of historic Richmondtown Civil War reenactment. Please share, like, and subscribe. Click the bell for notifications. I'll see you guys later.